Assalamu alaikum. How are you all? Hope everyone is doing well. And I think in the last class we have seen the phylum Platyhelminthes. And today we are going to learn about the phylum Nematoda, or even we can call it as Nematyhelminthes or Ascalminthes, as used in NCERT book also. So phylum Nematoda or Nematyhelminthes and Ascalminthes. So the body of nematode is circular. As we have learned about Platyhelminthes, platy, flat, helminth is the worm, right? Here nematode stands for nemati, that is round, and helminth is nothing but the parasite, the worms, okay? So the Nematyhelminthes are round worms. So hence, as they are circular, almost cylindrical in shape, and also they are considered as round worms. They may be free living or they may be parasitic. You can see some of the examples of nematode parasites here. Okay, they are also the endoparasites. They may be free living or parasitic. You can see them, infecting plants, animals. Okay, mostly the habitat is aquatic, or some of them may be terrestrial. Roundworms have organ system level of organization. So let us see the general characteristic features of this nematode, that is round worm. When I'm talking about the general characteristic features, I can say that, yeah, the body design here is tissue level of body design. Yeah. And they are pseudocoelomate. What do you mean by this pseudocoelomate? When I'm talking about pseudocoelomate, what does this, this pseudocoelom indicates here? Pseudo means false, coelom means body cavity. They have a type of false body cavity. Pseudo means false, right? So pseudocoelomate, that means they are now false body cavity. It appears as a body cavity, but it is not the true body cavity, as it is completely filled up by the digestive and other parts inside, and the body is long, slender, tapered at both the ends. What do you mean by that, tapered at both the ends? If I'm drawing this worm, okay, I want to just show tapered at both the ends. So the worm will be like this. So both the ends are tapered. Almost like when you learn about constricted muscles, you draw, and it is also tapered at both the ends. So this is the muscle that you can see. Worms are protostomes. Deuterostomes and protostomes. You know, mouth develops first. Deuterostome, anus develop first. So symmetry here, when I'm talking, it is by covered in a complex cuticle. The outer complete body is covered by a cuticle that is protecting the internals. And when I'm talking about a habitat, already I have discussed they are terrestrial. Okay, some of them may be even mostly aquatic. Some of them may be terrestrial, but they are actually the parasites that leave intestine in the tissues of the other organ. And if I can say, humans can be the host, and even some other organisms, even plants and animals can for this nematodes when it comes to elephantiasis. So we'll be discussing that. But let us see feeding. Both mouth and anus connected by the digestive tube. Worms have a mouth and also anus. That's the reason I have discussed here protostomes. Protostomes. So that means the germ layers and mesoderm, they form cleavage and they develop a mouth and an anus. If mouth develop first, then anus, then they are called as protostomes. If anus develop first, then the mouth, then they are called as deuterostome. That is what we have learned in our previous class. Already the video is available. You can have a look at that. And they are connected by that. Some of the examples here are hookworms, pinworms, gunia worms, and all. Let us see the next slide. Digestion. When I'm talking about digestion, it takes place in the digestive cavity, as the digestive system is well developed here with a mouth and an anus. So digested food diffuses into the other body tissues. So here microvilli, maybe these all things are not that complex. So digested food, it directly diffuses into the tissues of the body, and may also have digestive sacs that food is pumped into for digestion. Sometimes some of the nematodes are Rennet cells, the canal system. What do we call that as? We call that as Rennet cells. If I am writing, what are these Rennet cells? R-E-N-E, okay, T-T-E, Rennet cells. So in your higher classes also, you will be learning about this in detail, what are Rennet cells, how these are working and all. So Rennet cells are actually the excretory system, okay, consists of these glands and ducts. So where the canal system that diffuses the body wall out of the mouth, okay, body wall or out through the mouth, excretion occurs this way. And the nervous system, it is very simple nervous system with a main ventral belly nerve cord and a smaller dorsal back nerve cord. So you can see here, this is the nervous system present at this area, and it runs long. It appears like a brain here. Okay, the ventral belly that present here is like a brain ring like, and then all the nerves run like across. So very simple nervous system you can see, and they exhibit sexual dimorphism. Often females are longer than the males. See, you have seen before that most of the platyhelminthes are hermaphrodite. That means testes and ovaries are present in one organism. But here, when I'm talking, here you can see these organisms, they are sexually dimorphic. That means, you know, nematode Ascaris, if I'm talking, the females are larger when compared to the males. So, sexual dimorphism is seen. Males and females are separate here. So, one or two copulatory spicules or pineal are present. Fertilization is internal here, as male and female are separate. So, fertilization is internal here. But they are oviparous organisms that lay eggs, okay, especially Ascaris. Eukarya is a viviparous. They directly lay the, you know, what I can say, larvae, okay. The young one resembles the adult only, juvenile, we can call it as juvenile larvae and all. And when I'm talking about how, you know, especially the reproduction here, yeah, just now I have discussed they are sexual dimorphism, unisexual organism, sexes are separate, genders can be easily differentiated. You can see here, yeah, this is the female worm, which is longer when compared to the you know, male worms. The size and color of these parasites may differ, and sexual reproduction takes place internally, and but there are some of them may be oviparous and some of them may be viviparous, laying eggs or directly giving. Parasite requires host, yeah, for developing this to carry out the process of sexual reproduction. Again, they need an host organism. So, generally, feces and all that are seen nearby, and if things are not washed and we are consuming that, at that time they enter in our body and they cause complications. Again, when we pass the feces, again the larvae enters, their unfertilized eggs and larval stages will be seen here. Egg stages, again they enter in our body and the cycle continues. From infected person to the norm to the normal person, and so on. So over 1/3 of the human population potentially infested with these worms. Yeah, we are unaware of it. But ma'am, how the mobility in these organisms? Do also they have cilia, like yesterday you said, in platyhelminthes? Yes, this is the hookworm. This is the male whipworm. These are pinworms, eggs generally cage way that produce in our body. Even Ascaris can also be that. Pinworms are also the cage way that are produced in jelly like things and all. Mobility, muscles along body wall for movement. I mean, all the muscles, how snake move with the help of their crawling type, and also here these worms are also having the same. And one very important nematode parasite here I want to discuss you is filarial worm. Okay, that causes a disease called as filariasis, the picture here you are watching. And the name of that filarial worm is Eukarya brancofti. I repeat, Eukarya brancofti. So mosquitoes, you know, takes the blood. So larvae enters during that time when mosquitoes are, you know, to pierce the proboscis, there is release certain chemicals on our skin. During that time, what happens? This larvae of this filaria enters the body of human. But how mosquitoes get that, ma'am? Even mosquitoes, while drinking water in on the stagnant water and all, they directly ingest the filarial larvae. This filarial larvae penetrates inside the midgut of the mosquito, and the larvae develops and all. Larva stage 1, 2 and 3. Finally, when the larvae attempts a stage 3, at that time they migrate to the head of the mosquito near the proboscis. And when they want to penetrate that proboscis in our body to drink the blood, the larvae are easily released, and then infection starts. So this is the adult. You know, they affect the lymphatic system. These are the females, very long, and these are the males. Generally, Eukarya brancofti, it is said that males live inside the body of females sometimes. They live together also. So, adult produces sheathed microfilaria that migrate into lymph and blood and causes elephantiasis. Ma'am, elephantiasis, mein, what happens? Lymphatic system affect, or our lymph nodes are affecting and all. What exactly is happening here, ma'am? If you want to check the picture, these larvae, these worms grow in very large number in a very short period of time, causing, So this is the way, you know, your leg appears. As the worms are increasing in large number, it can, you know, it can affect your legs, your hands, your breast, your penis, even the testis. You can see the mouth, I haven't taken the pictures of that. You can Google and search how horrible this situation is. How actually they infect and how to overcome that. So when discussing about that parasitic infections and all you are having in your future further classes in the you know upcoming chapter, so we'll be discussing about the life cycles of them in detail. At that time I'll be explaining you what exactly happens there. As we are discussing only the general characteristic features, so now next we will move on to what are the classes. We have seen in Platyhelminthes they have been divided into three classes: Tubularia, Trematoda and Cestoda. But here in Nematoda they have been divided only into two classes. Phylum Nematoda classified into two classes, namely Ephasmida and Phasmida. A, without, okay, Gryphilla, Trichinella are the Ephasmida, and Phasmida are Ascaris, Eupheraria and Enchiostoma. All these are the examples. What do you mean by that? Ephasmida, in these members of this class, amphid, that means cuticular depressions, oral regions, okay, are highly modified. But phasmids mean glandular sensory structures are absent. That's the reason they got aphasmids, without these glandular structures. But phasmids have this glandular structures. Presence of these amphids are very simple, and also that's the reason they are called as phasmids and they are called as aphasmids. Ascaris, roundworm, hookworm, pinworm, filarial worm are the examples for this. So have a nice day, everyone. I'm stopping till here. Inshallah, we'll be meeting you in the next class. So take care, everyone.